Hello, and thank you for joining this second DEA World Forum webinar. I'm Carla Flodrowski, co-chair of the European Tuberous Sclerosis Complex Association, director of the Tuberous Sclerosis Complex Association in Italy, and member of the Tuberous Sclerosis Complex International Working Group. DEA, Disseminating Expertise and Achievement, World Forums are a spin-off from the DEA Pit Stops, small meetings bringing together key opinion leaders and clinicians in the world of TSC with families and individuals with TSC across the EU. This second webinar is organised by E-TSC together with TSCi and kindly hosted by the TS Alliance. Now over to the co-chair of TSCi, Katie Smith, for a few words.
Thank you, Carla, and thank you to everybody for joining us today. I'm Katie Smith. I'm the Director of Government and Global Affairs at the TS Alliance, as well as the co-chair of TSC International. As May is TSC Awareness Month, TSCi is pleased to be holding this webinar in coordination with E-TSC. I'm going to share my screen really quickly. That work? All right, so TSC International is the loose network of TSC organizations around the world. We currently have 38 member associations over six continents. It serves as a platform for sharing information and resources amongst the organization. And most recently, we've been working on a project looking at what gaps currently exist in TSC care around the world and how can we as patient organizations work together to help address those gaps. TSCi also sponsors TSC Global Awareness Day on May 15th. So hopefully everyone saw a lot of activity or through social media, lighting monuments up blue, people wearing blue. It's a really nice way that organizations can all work together to recognize TSC awareness on May 15th. Now I'll turn it back over to Carla to introduce the webinar.
Thank you, Katie. So today's DEA World Forum will focus on the International Consensus Guidelines. 79 key TSC opinion leaders from 15 different countries were involved in these. The chat box is open for your questions. Please feel free to post in and we'll make sure that they're all answered. The webinar will also be recorded and made available on our websites and social media. Before starting, it's my pleasure to introduce one of our mentors for the DEA project, and he is also a key figure in the International TSC Guidelines, Dr. John Bissler, pediatric nephrologist and director of the TSC Clinic at Lebanon Hospital in Memphis. Over to you, John.
Thank you very much, Carla. It's a real privilege to be part of the DEA World Forums as well as part of the TSC community. This has been a wonderful opportunity to interact not just with patients and families, but also other caregivers so that we can learn from what other caregivers are doing and they can learn from us. It's been a wonderful opportunity. And I'm really looking forward to being able to listen to some of the world leaders the complete organizers having to do with the consensus guidelines, Dr. Hope Northrup and Dr. Darcy Krueger. Thank you very much, Carla.
So I'll introduce the moderator for this session, Dr. José Carlos Ferreira. He's a pediatric neurologist, coordinator of pediatric neurology in Centro Hospitalar Lisbon Occidental in Lisbon, Portugal. So over to you, doctor.
Thank you very much. Welcome again. I'm very glad to be with you. And before I pass the word to the speakers, I just would like to share with you a small part of what the 2012 guidelines made for change in a small country like Portugal with about 10 million people. And we have the Portuguese TSC Association is very active and is very influent in a way. And somehow it got that the health authorities not only welcomed a group of experts to discuss the guidelines, but also to bring these guidelines into a Portuguese norm make light in 2018. If I can share with you, this is the This is the guidelines, the norms. If you can see, it's something that rules somehow the diagnosis and the follow-up of the people with TSC and how the doctors in all the country should be aware of this disease and to refer the patients to some centers that may have a good diagnosis and a good follow-up. This is a group of experts that were responsible for these norms. And of course, the first two references were the two guidelines that the two articles of the guidelines in 29 references. So we have also participated and we have also benefited from these guidelines very, very much and very directly. So I don't know if we're going directly to the speakers. So it's my
yes
pleasure to introduce the Dr. Hope Northrup. She's a medical geneticist, co-director of the TS Center of Excellence at McGovern Medical School and Memorial Hermann Hospital in Houston, Texas. Please, Hope.
Thank you so much, JC. And I'm going to try to share my screen, see if I can figure out exactly what's going on here. Can everyone see my slides now in yes. presentation mode? I see nodding from John Bissler. And that reminds me to say thank you so much to John Bissler and Mika Rosenberg for the kind invitation. I really appreciate having an opportunity to talk to families, people with tuberous sclerosis and their families and any healthcare professionals who have joined us. I'm going to focus mostly on diagnostic guidelines, and then Dr. Krueger is going to talk more about surveillance and management. Is it going forward? It doesn't seem like it's, got a little bit of a glitch. Okay, so I love this quote from the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance that says, "Tuberous sclerosis complex, often undetected and easily misdiagnosed," and this is so true. I've seen so many patients who've been on a diagnostic odyssey to try to figure out their diagnosis. And I think this highlights and underlines for us the importance of having diagnostic criteria. We want to really be able to make the diagnosis and have all healthcare professionals on the same page to think about the condition and to diagnose it. We want to understand the extent of the phenotype, and we also want to view it as sort of a living set of criteria, in that we want to update it as information becomes available and changes over time. So diagnosing tuberous sclerosis has always been a challenge, and it was a huge challenge prior to the 1980s and very much underdiagnosed at 1 in 100,000 to 1 in 200,000 people. And we now know there are about 1 in 20,000 people who have it as a population prevalence, and 1 in 6,000 to 1 in 10,000 at the time of birth. What makes it tricky is that 2/3 of the time when we see a person with tuberous sclerosis, nobody else in their family ever had it. There's no family history, there's no good clues. we also know that there's no one particular finding that can lead us to the diagnosis and make us say, oh, this is definitely tuberous sclerosis. So we've known about tuberous sclerosis for almost 150 years. It was first described in the 1880s by a Frenchman named Bourneville. And over the years, the term tuberous sclerosis came to be known. And in fact, in 1979, Dr. Manuel Gomez, who was a very passionate pediatric neurologist at the Mayo Clinic, very passionate about tuberous sclerosis, he wrote the first diagnostic criteria. Well, in 1998, many of us thought, well, he had great criteria, and he acknowledged that he had these nice criteria, but it might be better to get input from a group of people to try to figure out what should these diagnostic criteria be. And so in 1998, I was privileged to co-chair the first consensus conference held in Annapolis, Maryland. And at that conference, what we really focused on was diagnostic criteria. We didn't even think about surveillance and management. And then in 2012, we knew it was time to update that and go further and look at surveillance and management guidelines. You'll notice that the tuberous sclerosis genes had been found before that conference in 1998, but there was nothing in the information from that conference about the genetics of tuberous sclerosis and how that could be used for diagnosis. The reason being that at that time in 1998, genetic testing for tuberous sclerosis was not clinically available. It did not become clinically available until 2001, and now it's pretty much ubiquitously available in the United States. And in 1998, this is what we came up with. We came up with 11 major features and 9 minor features. Dr. Gomez's previous diagnostic criteria included primary, secondary, and tertiary features and had many, many more findings of tuberous sclerosis included, but some of those were very nonspecific, things like seizures. So we decided to try to bring it together more and get rid of some of the very nonspecific, if you will, findings that we can see in a lot of other diagnoses. So in 2012, we came together, and as Carla already mentioned, this included more than 80 experts from 14 countries, and we really wanted to go further than the initial diagnostic criteria from 98 and add surveillance and management, and this was published in Pediatric Neurology, as you've seen, in 2 companion articles. So what we came up with in 2012 is what you see on the slide. We decreased our minor features from 9 to 6. We kept 11 major features, but did some wordsmithing about those. And we cut down to 2 diagnostic categories, definite and possible. In about 2017, 5 years after the 2012 meeting, we all started thinking, well, a lot's happened. It's been 5 years, and we probably need to update again. And so a decision was made, and with the support of the TS Alliance, the panels, the 12 panels from the 2012 meeting were reconstituted with the same chair of each panel, if that person was willing and available. And we did, again, meetings ahead of time, 6 months ahead of the TSC World meeting in Dallas, Texas, in the summer of 2018. And the panels came together and decided, did they want to update any of the recommendations that they had from before? And for the diagnostic criteria, my slides are not working like they're supposed to. Nope. Okay, so for the diagnostic criteria, we decided to delete the term cortical dysplasia that you see here, and go back to the previous terms that we used of tubers and cerebral white matter migration lines, because we'd gotten too nonspecific, and we decided to add back in to the minor features sclerotic bone lesions. And these sclerotic bone lesions are, we realized, were much more important and shouldn't be left out, because women who have LAM, who have their chest CTs done, often have these lesions. And when you see this lesion, this alerts you that that person who has LAM, that woman who has LAM, has tuberous sclerosis instead of sporadic LAM. And so we wanted to add that back in. And the other reason we added it back in was because some tuberous sclerosis patients had had the unfortunate circumstance of these lesions being observed and their care providers thinking that they might have a metastatic malignancy and having workup for cancer. So we wanted to add that back in. So those are the main updates for the diagnostic criteria for 2018. We met for about 6 months before TSC World, and at TSC World in 2 half days, the different panel chairs got together and discussed what we wanted to recommend. So this is really an update of the changes from 1998 to 2012. And the other big thing you see on the left-hand side of the slide is that we decided that we would add genetic testing as a standalone diagnostic criteria. That is completely separate from clinical diagnostic criteria. If you were negative for genetic testing, this wouldn't take away a clinical diagnosis. But if you're positive for genetic testing and didn't meet your clinical diagnostic criteria, you would have that diagnosis. And by doing this, we were hoping to get patients who maybe had not yet developed enough clinical criteria to make the diagnosis, but who nevertheless have tuberous sclerosis and deserve to have that close surveillance, management, follow-up by their healthcare providers. Here's the one I was looking for. So we deleted cortical dysplasias from clinical criteria and changed it back to multiple cortical tubers and or radial migration lines. We added sclerotic bone lesions and increased minor features to 7. So when we initially said that genetic testing would be a diagnostic criteria, it was with all of the caveats you see on the slide. That is, it needed to be a change in TSC1 or TSC2 that we know is a pathogenic variant. It changes the production of the protein, and that was very important. And we wanted to be sure that just variants of uncertain significance, this is a change in one of the genes that's identified and we don't know whether it affects the protein production or not, not be included, and that those be in a different category. We also knew at that time that 10 to 25% of patients, depending on lab that was utilized and studies that were done, wouldn't have a mutation identified. And so we wanted to confirm and make sure everyone understood that this lack of a molecular finding didn't take away a clinical diagnosis. So in the 5 years between 2012 and 2017, quite a bit happened in the genetics world that affected tuberous sclerosis. One thing that happened was we moved away from Sanger sequencing toward next generational sequencing. And this is a different method to look at the genes, and this method is actually better to find mosaicism. So you remember mosaicism means that in some cells of your body you have a change in TSC1 or 2, but not in the other cells of your body. And mosaicism can be hard to find, especially with Sanger sequencing, but it's easier to find with next generational sequencing. So we had this new method that was going to help us identify more patients who had mosaicism of a change as the reason for their diagnosis. We also were able, with next generational sequencing, as was shown in a number of studies, more readily able to find the pathogenic variants. So this was an improvement in our testing capability. The other thing that had happened since 2012 was that a lot of people were being tested for TSC1 and TSC2, not because the doctor or healthcare professional who saw them thought they might have tuberous sclerosis, but simply because they might have a nonspecific finding like seizures or autism. And you can see on the slide that TSC1 and 2 were included in what we call seizure panels. And these are gene panels where there can be hundreds of genes, all known to be involved in causing seizures, that are included and tested in the patient. Similarly for autism, for intellectual disability, as well as for cancer. And then finally, a new test called whole exome sequencing that looks at all of your genes in a hypothesis-free manner became clinically available in November of 2012. And remember, our meeting was in November 2011, and our meeting was in June of 2012. So just 6 months before the meeting, this new test became available. and this test gained great and widespread popularity. So again, many people are being tested for the TSC1 and 2 genes, where the reason they're being tested is not because anybody thinks they have tuberous sclerosis. So what this has caused to happen is that we now identify people with changes in the genes who had previously been completely unrecognized as potentially having tuberous sclerosis. So we now know that we've greatly expanded the phenotype because we have many more examples of people with pathogenic variants in the TSC1 and TSC2 genes that we didn't really recognize before. The other thing that's had a lot of action and we've done a lot of work on is genotype-phenotype correlations. That is, finding out what someone's genetic cause for their tuberous sclerosis is, and then looking at that person for their findings. And what we've discovered is that there are a number of changes in the gene, particularly TSC2, where we see a pathogenic change, and the people who have that particular pathogenic change have many less findings than other people who have tuberous sclerosis. So what this allows us to do is if we see a little baby who has hypomelanitic macules and we're worried about tuberous sclerosis and we find out exactly what their change is, if they have some of the changes that you see listed here on this slide, I'll say this change here, arginine to tryptophan and codon 1200 of TSC2, we know that that patient is going to have many less findings than other people who have tuberous sclerosis. And so this sort of opens up the idea that we can give better prognostic information in a baby or a newly diagnosed individual if they happen to have one of these changes. And we're finding more and more instances where this is the case. So these genotype-phenotype correlations, we hope, are going to allow healthcare providers to more accurately tailor surveillance and management. Of course, we have our gold standard guidelines that Dr. Krueger is going to talk about next, but we have to use our medical judgment when someone has a change that we know doesn't, for example, give a problem with the kidneys. And we have to use our medical judgment to help families not have more testing and more surveillance than they need. And finally, I want to leave you with a hopeful area in genetics that's being hotly pursued at this time, and that is studies looking at modifier genes. So these are the genes other than TSC1 and 2 that we all have, and whether changes in some of those genes actually influence what happens to people who have tuberous sclerosis. And this has been well shown in other diseases like cystic fibrosis or spinal muscular atrophy, and we even tried showing this in the early 2000s or in the 2000s in tuberous sclerosis. But now we're able to do it in a much more systematic manner. My colleague, Dr. Laura Farich, currently has funding from the Department of Defense TSCRP program and from the TS Alliance to look in a systematic way to study the seizure phenotype in tuberous sclerosis and whether there's information we can use for a prediction risk model, as well as information we can use from their genes, and that's the next stage and where we are right now to analyze that data, that may help us to actually move even further into personalized medicine for people who have tuberous sclerosis. There may be a dozen other genes that have variants that influence about your seizures, when they happen, whether or not you have autism, and so forth. So in summary, clinical diagnosis is certainly not negated by a lack of a genetic diagnosis. We have clinical diagnostic criteria and we have the genetic diagnostic criteria. We're now more and more often able to use the genetic information to give prognostic information to the family, as well as to provide better surveillance and management guidelines using medical judgment. And finally, I'm hoping that in the future, we're going to have some modifier gene information that again helps us provide more personalized medicine for people with tuberous sclerosis. And with that, I'm going to close and I am going to turn it over to my partner in crime, Dr. Krueger, who was the other person who chaired the 2012 Consensus Conference. Take it away, Darcy.
You're mute, Darcy.
Okay, I'm unmuted. Now I'm trying to navigate multiple screens. Give me a second here, which is not working. Here we go. All right. I apologize. Close that. Share my screen. All right. All right. So I just want to remind everyone what went into the 2012 consensus conference. We had 79 TSC specialists that came together representing all the different aspects of how TSC clinically affects a person who has the diagnosis. This represented 5 different continents and worked very much in parallel with similar efforts that had been done, particularly with the European community specialists that had put out recommendations as well. But we set out to make these a worldwide representation. And we also, before we started, set out standards on what type of evidence we would consider that supported a recommendation and areas where there was not enough information for a recommendation to move forward on a global level. And as you guys, as you all know, these have been published, and I always like to throw this slide in here. There's multiple ways to get it, but I find the simplest, both through TSC International and the Tuberous Sclerosis Alliance. We want these in the hands of doctors. We want these in the hands of patients because they don't do any good if people don't use them and follow them. At least myself, I'm painfully aware of situations where patients have advocated for following these guidelines and the physicians have discounted those requests with negative consequences. And I hope to make a plea here on how certain situations, this has certainly proven to be true, that failure to follow these recommendations can have negative consequences. Now, as Dr. Northrup mentioned, a lot has happened since 2012. When we started in 2012, we have done a lot of work using the mTOR inhibitors, everolimus and sirolimus, for the treatment of tuberous sclerosis with great success. And at the time of the recommendations in 2012, we had studies published that showed that you could treat SAGAs with everolimus and that renal angiomyomas could be treated successfully with sirolimus and everolimus. And at that point, we had approvals from many governments around the world to treat these two aspects of TSC with these specific drugs. And these were integrated into the 2012 guidelines. But since then, we've had two additional developments that are just as significant. In 2015, we had approval of sirolimus for the treatment of lymphangioliomyomatosis in multiple countries. And then most recently, in 2018, we had the approval of everolimus for the treatment of refractory epilepsy and tuberous sclerosis. And so these new developments had not been fully They had been considered because trials were underway or had been published on some level, but they were not to the level that they met evidence-based recommendations, and we have that now. So I'm going to talk about just three areas where the guidelines, we hope, when they are completed and updated in this most recent iteration, we hope that is this year. I'm going to talk about renal, I'm going to talk about dermatology or skin, and then I'll finish up with advancements in the brain that we hope to incorporate. I don't need to talk to this audience about the extent of renal disease and its importance. And indeed, this was a significant portion of what the guidelines aim to accomplish in optimal outcomes for patients with TSC. One of the things you'll see in all these slides is that we have now the data from the TSCi registry, which was a world registry of TSC patients that was collected of patients that had many different ages, as you can see here, even into adulthood. And it now is really the best registry data we have to date of how these manifestations, how often they are present in patients with TSC. And we have, these are the recommendations published, and for time purposes, I'm not going to go through these in specific detail, But there have been a couple of things I think that are worth highlighting that we want to even increase further the prevalence and the prominence of what we recommend on patients for management of TSC outcomes as it relates to the kidneys. There have been several studies that look at survivability of tuberous sclerosis and look at reasons why people pass away who have this diagnosis and compare that with the general population. This is one that was done by the group in Europe in the Netherlands, where they looked at all causes of why patients pass away. And if you look here, there's a dotted line here. This is what the normal population death rate is in the Netherlands. And what you see here in the solid, I want you to ignore these little dotted lines, but what you see here in the solid blue line is that especially, you know, very within the early adulthood and mid-adulthood years, that many TSC patients are passing away on average 10 to 20 years earlier than somebody who is the identical age who does not have a diagnosis of TSC. And so this just shows that that failure to take care of the kidney health of patients with TSC has very real consequences with regard to long-term survivability. And then this is a second study that I like to use frequently in my presentations. And this comes from the United Kingdom, a study that was led by Dr. Chris Kingswood. And what we see here is renal function compared to the normal population in the United Kingdom. And you see that over time, there's an increasing risk to kidney health in general for many different reasons, high blood pressure, diabetes, and many smoking, and many other risk factors that eventually contribute to that. But even with all of that, when you take a diagnosis of tuberous sclerosis, you see that the kidneys fail or start to have less renal function much earlier, 10 to 15 years earlier compared to the general population. So it's not even just mortality from kidney disease, but also renal function is significantly impacted earlier on in life. And we need to highlight that in the new recommendations. And that is our goal. Moving on to skin, we see that there's many different manifestations of TSC that involve the skin. And indeed, many of these are major diagnostic criteria because they really are unique to a large extent to tuberous sclerosis and really help us make that diagnosis. Now, not all of them happen at the same time in somebody's lifespan. Some of them occur when they're older. Other ones occur with high frequency compared to maybe other ones, such as a shagreen patch or a forehead plaque is less frequent than the white spots or the facial antifibromas. But all in all, these are highly prevalent in TSC and help us make the diagnosis. Now, in the original recommendations, it was recommended that that these get evaluated annually so that we can see the extent of TSC. And in the rare instances that these become problematic, where they're bleeding or they're hurting or they're disfiguring, or they're affecting social self-esteem and status, that these definitely should be treated. And it was known that mTOR inhibitors were being investigated for treatment, but none of the major clinical trials had been completed yet in order for us to know what role mTOR inhibitors might have in treatment of various skin manifestations for TSC. I want to highlight a study that was led by the University of Texas in Houston by Mary Kay Koenig and Dr. Northrup as a co-investigator and the dermatology group there that specifically in a well-designed prospective clinical trial developed a cream that was standardized and administered to all their patients in a blinded fashion. And what you see here on the left are pictures of various patients who participate in this trial. And on the right, you see the results of all the patients together in a graphical form. But you see those who received 1% or 0.1% rapamycin had a very favorable response with regards to how prominent and how symptomatic their angiofibromas were. This trial has now served to be the basis for multiple companies that are now pursuing this so that we can have a prescription-based form of this cream that can be approved by agencies like the FDA and ultimately covered by insurance and other payers for medical care in the different countries involved. Until then, we continue to have multiple recipes that are circulated. We use multiple recipes here in Cincinnati, but they're not standardized and they're not covered by insurance in most instances. So we certainly look forward to the day coming when we do that. But we now at least have well-designed clinical trials that show that facial creams that contain rapamycin or sirolimus can be effective for the treatment of angiofibromas, and we want to work this information into the new guidelines. Lastly, I'm going to talk about, with the time remaining, on brain manifestation TSC, because there has been an explosion of new information that has come out of multiple clinical consortia, both in Europe, Australia, and in the United States, that have been working along testing and evaluating better strategies to diagnose and or treat the major manifestations that involve the brain. And these are nodules, these include tubers, and these include subependymal giant cell astrocytomas, or SEGA. And the clinical consequences, I'm going to skip this because these are published, but the clinical consequences is what happens if MRIs are not done every 1 to 3 years. One of the things is I travel, particularly to countries where resources are limited or restricted by the government. I have many families that say either they can't get an MRI or their doctor won't order an MRI, even though it's been recommended in the guidelines. So the question is, you know, what's the worst that can happen? And the question is, it's pretty bad. Now, this is a patient from our clinic. They were from Africa, but they had moved to the United States. And then when he was 4, this is the first MRI that we got for this young man. And we wanted to start him on treatment with everolimus, but the family did not return our calls and they didn't come back to clinic until he turned 7. And he went to his local primary general practitioner, his pediatrician, and he was throwing up. He was having trouble seeing and he could not walk straight. He was falling down. And the pediatrician sent him to the emergency room where he got a CAT scan or attack tomography. And you see here that the tumor had exploded in those 3 years. We would have imaged this kid with this known lesion that we see over here when he was 4. We would image that every 6 to 12 months, knowing that it had significant risk. And here he is 3 years later with a huge tumor. So surveillance imaging matters. It matters for the kidneys and it matters for the brain. And that's why this is in the recommendations. There's also situations like this patient. I've shared this with many of you over the years, of a patient who was at a different clinic, and she presented with an acute SEGA, and she was clumsy, but she couldn't talk. She was developmentally delayed and nonverbal, and so her doctors basically told the mother it was nothing and not to worry. But the mother continued to be concerned and took the child to the emergency room on her own. And that's where this tumor was discovered. And it was operated on, which you see in the middle, and operated on fairly successfully. There were some medical complications. She had bleeding to where she almost died a day after her surgery. But she recovered. But when 3 months later, a follow-up scan showed that tumor had returned again. So this is another reason, even if it's been operated on, these patients need to continue to have MRI imaging every 1 to 3 years. We also care about the tubers. Tubers don't really change over time, but their impact on the brain does, with significant risk for learning and cognitive impairments, for attention difficulties, autism, and in the vast majority of patients, epilepsy. And in over half of those patients, we will struggle to control seizures, even with the medications that we have available to us. So there's recommendations for EEGs to be done in these patients. There's recommendations that vigabatrin, which now has many generic versions available throughout the world, as the first line treatment of infantile spasms. And physicians, neurologists that continue to just prescribe other treatments for infantile spasms in these patients are committing malpractice. They are not following very well-established evidence on how to treat patients with tuberous sclerosis who present with infantile spasms. We also now know that mTOR inhibitors such as everolimus and cannabidiol can be effective, and I'll show you that evidence that we did not have in 2012. The other thing that's happened since 2012 is we now realize the importance of doing EEGs in babies with TSC, even if they've never had a seizure. We did a well-designed study here in the United States where we enrolled babies from birth who had never had a seizure and started doing EEGs on them every month and a half, every 6 weeks. And we found that the EEGs predicted that seizures were soon to occur in almost 80% of patients. And if patients continue to have normal EEGs, then they would go the next month at least without any new onset seizures in almost three out of every four patients. So while neither one is 100%, these are very helpful for us to alert us on which babies are getting ready to start to have seizures, and we can be ready with vigabatrin for the treatment for that patient. We usually have an average of about 3 months between the time that an EEG starts to be abnormal and the patient will start seizing, even though there will be some exceptions to that rule where patients will seize within a week or even days of having their first abnormal EEG. We also find that many times these patients will have partial seizures and not just infantile spasms, and this is important for clinicians to recognize and treat aggressively. And we found that when you treat them aggressively, deterioration of the EEG to a pattern that we call hypsarrhythmia or modified hypsarrhythmia is very rare, that we can actually prevent the brain from deteriorating down into this abyss of disorganized activity that is known to occur if infantile spasms are not recognized and treated promptly. The other information we have from one of our studies that we've done in the consortium is that this hesitance to dose vigabatrin appropriately, there are doctors that will try to dose very low with vigabatrin, and they will try to remove vigabatrin after just 6 or 10 to 12 weeks of treatment. And what we find is that when this happens, when dosing is too short and too low, that those patients have a very much higher, significantly higher risk of having the infantile spasms return. And so we recommend, and we have evidence suggests that dosing needs to be at least 100 milligrams per kilogram per day, and even 150 milligrams per kilogram per day may be even more appropriate than that. But this is an important message to get out because of those doctors who are hesitant, or even parents that hear about vigabatrin and its potential side effects and feel that they need to avoid it or to reduce the amount of treatment, when really it's the opposite here when we talk about protecting the brain and adequately treating their epilepsy. And this is now in the process of taking one step further of two major collaborative studies, one in Europe and the other one in the United States, that are even looking at treating vigabatrin before the patient has seizures based on their EEG and see if that can prevent future epilepsy or future learning difficulties that occur with epilepsy in these patients. So that we expect to even have to do a further update to these recommendations in the coming years, because this will be a monumental finding if proven successful. We also have two new treatments that didn't exist in 2012 for the treatment of epilepsy TSC. As I mentioned, we now have approvals to use everolimus specifically to treat epilepsy that's not responding to other medications. And this was known as EXIST-1, and many patients around the world participated in this study that was sponsored by Novartis and found that we could significantly reduce seizures over time. And in fact, the longer and the higher dose the patients were on treatment, the better responses that we had. And this is an example of patients that were treated at 3 months. We had a 30% response rate. And by those patients who continued treatment for 2 years, the responder rate went up to 60%. And most recently, and what we are very excited about, is cannabis products for the treatment of epilepsy, and particularly our ability to get a pharmaceutical grade product that has cannabidiol, the main active ingredient in cannabis products, to treat refractory epilepsy. It's been shown to be effective for other epilepsies that don't respond to traditional medicines. And the trial done by Greenwich Biosciences evaluating the pharmaceutical version of cannabidiol for treating refractory epilepsy was successful. And what we see here is two different doses, 25 milligrams per kilogram or 50 milligrams per kilogram. And what we see here compared to placebo, that the reduction in seizures was almost in half with both doses. So now we usually try to treat somewhere between 10 and 20 milligrams per kilogram to capture this group of patients using the pharmaceutical version of cannabidiol. And so this has been shared publicly in meetings, and we're excited and we're hopeful to have approval, at least in the United States, later this year. That application has been submitted, and we're waiting to hear back from the FDA whether they'll approve it or not. And finally, we did mention in 2012 the importance of epilepsy surgery. We knew that many TSC patients can benefit from epilepsy surgery. It does require a pretty extensive evaluation process, because I tell my patients we have to answer two questions before we can propose epilepsy surgery for a patient. One is, how certain are we where the seizures are coming from? If we don't know where the seizures start, we don't know where to operate. And the surgeons can't be expected, and you and I certainly would not agree to, for our children or our brothers or sisters to undergo a surgery where the surgeons don't know what to remove. And then the second question is just as important, which is, if we remove the section that we plan to remove, is this going to result in long-term negative consequences? In other words, can the brain adapt and recover from this surgery, or can the brain not recover the part of the that they're removing by using a different part of the brain? You know, so how safe is the surgery? But we find that there are many, many TSC patients for which they're having seizures, even daily seizures, for which the surgeons and the epilepsy teams, and it's a multi-member team to answer these two questions, where the seizures come from, and they can safely remove them and have very, very favorable improvements. If not seizure freedom, at least removal of a significant portion of the seizures, such that it allows the brain to wake up and start to move forward developmentally. So in the studies, there's multiple large studies that have been done between 2012 and now that show that resective surgery in TSC offers roughly a 50 to 60% chance of long-term seizure freedom. But it still today is underused by many patients and many clinics. So just to close, the international consensus recommendation for TSC had definitely been helpful. They provided a uniform standard of care for best outcomes for patients, and they are applicable all through the world. Even in resource-limited countries, we can still strive for the best. And if there has to be compromises made in what can or can't be done, well, certainly we can start to understand what those compromises, consequences are, and strive for still ways in the future to improve those so that the patients can get the same care wherever they live. And the second thing is to understand is that there has been a lot that's happened since 2012, particularly for our management of epilepsy and learning, our management and understanding the importance of renal disease, and new treatments such as treatment of angiofibromas that we can apply now that we weren't in a position to do in 2012. So thank you, and I'll end there.
Thank you very much for both Darcy and Hope for these wonderful presentations that led us through all the important aspects of the 2012 guidelines and all the amazing developments that came after them. Please, I lead this to the questions and answers. I think the
great. Thank you so much to both presenters for providing a really comprehensive update. We have a couple of questions from the chat. One question: what have been some of the challenges to getting those 2018 updates published in a medical journal?
Darcy, do you want me to start? And maybe
why don't you start that?
Okay, so, you know, getting together that many people is a little bit like getting together a herd of cats. And it's been hard in some instances to get a particular panel or a group to provide us with their summary, even though we talked about it face-to-face with the leaders of each panel when we were in the World Conference in 2.5 days. So it's been a little challenging for us to make sure that we get the input from the leader of that particular panel with 12 panels, you can imagine, because people have, you know, many things on their plate. So I think part of it has been for us to get all the input from the panels in writing that we've tried, despite begging in some cases, asking very forcefully. I see Darcy almost smiling there. So that's been part of it. And I'd let Darcy go on to add more.
No. I mean, that's definitely a part of it, but that's not the whole of it. As many of you know, this is important. So I don't want to discount that. But a challenge for me personally has been that this is not the only thing that I've been working on. As many of you know, we've been working in the consortium for these preventative clinical trials. It started with the TSC Cure effort that was first discussed at the TSC World Conference in Beijing, China. And those have continued to move forward as well. And then at the end of the day, again, this is maybe my own personal weakness, but I prioritize patient care over all else. And I have not stopped taking care of patients, and many patients still continue to struggle with how TSC throws their life upside down. From the day that they get the first diagnosis to the first time that a medicine that we hoped would work isn't working anymore, to discussing the anxiety around a referral for epilepsy surgery, or even to proceed with epilepsy surgery based on the recommendations of the surgery team. And then, you know, dealing with not just brain, but we're dealing with school, we're dealing with home, we're dealing with other medical complications. So it's multifactorial. None of these are adequate excuses, I want to say, but they are the reasons why it's taking longer than we hoped.
Well, we definitely appreciate all of your efforts in continuing to work towards publishing these guidelines. Another question from the chat for you, Dr. Krueger, concerning the use of topical rapamycin for angiofibromas. Did the research show that there were any side effects for long-term use?
The trial was not a long-term trial. We do have patients that continue to take treatment clinically. And we have not seen any long-term user complications from topical creams. The side effects in the short term, some patients find that the creams are still irritating, and it's a minority of patients, but not a zero number, and we have to deal with that when it happens. But it's very, very well tolerated, and the clinical trial that University of Texas Houston did look for evidence that the drug was getting into their whole body system by checking the blood levels, and they never found it detected there. So we are fairly confident that side effects are minimal and they are limited only to the surface of the skin if a patient is allergic or irritated by the cream itself. Dr. Northrup, you're intimately aware of that trial. Would you add anything else?
I wouldn't just reinforce that we did drug levels in blood and it is not absorbed. So that's good news, because you can actually be on an mTOR inhibitor for a SEGA and still use the topical at the same time and really attack your skin lesions from two directions. So that sometimes for patients, they like to use the topical because it isn't as much better as they would hope when they're on a systemic use of an mTOR inhibitor. And that so, and we can confidently do that because we know it's not absorbed.
Great. Along the same kind of line, there's a question about using mTOR inhibitors for treating epilepsy. So if someone is using an mTOR inhibitor for the treatment of epilepsy and they've seen a seizure reduction, should they continue to use it through their lifetime to also treat AMLs and kidneys?
I think in the guidelines update, we're going to touch on, if not this topic, something very similar. But we have to be careful because it is something that, as a consensus, means that we have to agree as TSC experts on this what I'm about to say, which is we develop these treatments based on very specific what we call endpoints in clinical studies, meaning we give the medication and we have something very specific that we're measuring to see if the medication works or doesn't work. But in many of those studies, we look at other parts of TSC, even if they aren't the main endpoint, and we have consistently seen that while we're treating SEGAs, angiomyopomas respond. Or if we treat angiomyopomas, SEGAs respond, or the skin gets clearer. And so there are a number of us who start to think about these treatments as treating TSC rather than treating SEGA or treating angiomyopomas or treating epilepsy. But that's really hard to define, and it's really hard scientifically to make that leap. And there are definitely some TSC specialists that understand and agree with that statement, and others say, no, it's specifically for these indications that it's been tested for, and without that evidence, we can't know. So getting back to the original question, if it's working for epilepsy, would you continue treatment for other things? In our clinic, we do. And it's probably still at this stage something that's decided clinic by clinic. I don't know if Dr. Northrup, and I know that we have other TSCi specialists here on the call, if they would agree or disagree with that statement, but we certainly would continue treatment for treating TSC and not specifically just epilepsy.
I agree. I mean, when you take an mTOR inhibitor, you're treating all the problems in tuberous sclerosis at once. And that's one of the beautiful things about the mTOR inhibitors is you're treating everything at the same time. I think that your epileptologist or your neurologist is going to help you about your seizures and decide what's working and what isn't working. And if you are not, if you don't need the mTOR inhibitor anymore for your epilepsy, I don't know if you would go off of it and see if you get other signs and symptoms of tumors growing in your kidneys or growing in your brain that would cause you to go back on it, or whether you would just stay on it prophylactically. I think that would be really a healthcare provider decision at your individual location.
Great. You touched on the EpiStop and Prevent trial. What is the status of these two trials? And then there's a question about whether early intervention can improve neuropsychological development in a child.
I'll start with the second one. There certainly are studies that suggest that early intervention changes the outcome. And this is not just unique to TSC. There are multiple research groups, for example, looking at early autism with the focus of identifying autism as early as possible, which is not a simple endeavor. Integrating interventional therapies, not drugs per se, but interventional therapies very early on that can have significant impact on the outcome. So the answer for that is definitely true. And there are multiple groups in and outside of TSC, and many of us are working together with groups outside of TSC in collaboration specifically to learn more about how to do this well. And then secondly, which therapies, whether they be drug or non-drug therapies, should be done in order to change outcome. As regard to the status of the PREVENT and EpiStop trials, the EpiStop trial started about 3 years before the PREVENT trial, so it had a head start. And it has finished both its recruitment and its primary endpoint visits, such that they have completed at least a start to their analysis of results. And I know that they are working on publishing those results. They've shared little pieces of this at various scientific meetings, but I don't want, because those are considered preliminary and not yet peer reviewed, I can't really comment on what those results showed. But we're expecting in 2020 to see some results from the EpiStop trial, and whether those are favorable or whether those are still some unanswered questions has yet to be seen. The PREVENT trial has finished its enrollment. Its first set of participants will, we believe, be able to be analyzed in early 2022. And so we're hoping we'll start doing some preliminary analyses before then, but we won't have the final answer of whether or not preventive treatment should be done until 2022. Unfortunately, it takes that long to get answers, and we've been wrong before, where we've recommended therapies because they sounded good and because there were studies of 10 patients or 20 patients in a particular location. And it's proven not to be true. We're going through that right now with the questions around COVID-19 and the use of malaria drugs, that there has been definitely some information suggests they could be helpful, but there's been other studies that have clearly shown that there's harmful side effects that are worse than the treatment. So we've got to at least get those answers before we start giving babies drugs without knowing why we're giving them.
Thank you. A question for Dr. Northrup. You talked about the correlation between genotype and phenotype. If someone is, how definitive is that? So for example, if someone has a genotypic marker that suggests they should have mild symptoms, does that still mean they're at risk for more severe manifestations of TSC?
It would depend on which pathogenic variant you're talking about and how much information we have available in the medical literature. So I think that's something that you'd want to talk to your own medical geneticist about, who has seen you or your child, to discuss how much information we have. But it looks like it really does hold true for a number of these variants, that every single person who's been reported with that particular variant looks pretty similar, and they have maybe less findings than we would expect them to have. It's really very much of a medical judgment question, I think, when you have your own healthcare providers to look at that information and decide how much they feel confident that they can do more or less on surveillance and management than is the standard recommendation. And we're never going to have recommendations for every single variant because there are thousands. So we're going to have our general guidelines of surveillance and management as our gold standard that we're going by. But then when people have these different variants that's been reported in the medical literature, your healthcare provider is going to need to read that and see what they think in regards to that finding. We just don't have, doing one for every single variant would take more time than I can imagine for tailored surveillance and management. And that's why, you know, you go to your doctors and nurses and all your healthcare providers. You want them to use their judgment too.
Another question from the chat, and Dr. Krueger, you kind of touched on this earlier. In countries where doctors are not as familiar with TSC, how can people advocate with their primary care provider to make sure that they're following these guidelines?
That's really tricky because there's a lot of different factors involved, and at the center of it is a lot of people's egos. I'm part of a professional group that is known for having egos that sometimes get in the way of making good decisions. And so I believe there's a couple different principles that I find very helpful when patients come to me about treatments that I am not familiar with. And this happens not infrequently, even today. One is, an informed patient, I always believe, is good. So the more the patients that are on here that are learning about these things, I think starting from a position of knowledge can only help. The second is, I've seen both good and bad examples what to do with that information. I have had parents come into my office and say, we want to do this new treatment for autism that has never really been studied. I've never heard of it. And they're just demanding I do it. And I instantly get defensive, even if it's a family that I love and care dearly about, that just doesn't help me feel good about our relationship and how we're approaching an unproven therapy. On the same front, I have had families come in with saying, hey, we've heard about this new treatment. Let's use medical marijuana, for example. It's all over the internet. It's curing world peace. You know, we'll never suffer again. We just need to start this treatment. But they say, hey, what do you know about it? You know, and when I say, hey, I haven't heard any studies about it, but I'm willing to look into it. And then let me get back with you. That type of conversation I find is much more helpful. We form a partnership. We're able to say, hey, this is what they say it can do. This is what I'm nervous or uneasy about. How do you feel about those two things? And then sometimes, well, let's give it a try for a little bit. So long story short, come into it as a partner. And then lastly, I have very, I'll put very blunt words for my medical colleagues that if you're not open to learning about ways that medicine is changing, particularly for rare diseases that you and I may not see very often, we need to be willing to change our practice. And if we're not willing to have these dialogues with parents that have taken the time to become informed because it affects them very personally, then I feel no shame in recommending to these parents and these patients that tell me that they had negative experiences to say, you need to go find another doctor. Because there's lots of good doctors that have done excellent things in medical school, but if they can't talk to patients and listen to patients and be partners, then there's a problem in that care. So that's all I can say for those situations where people are hitting a lot of resistance. The last piece I would say is work with your associations within your country. There is strength in numbers. There's strength in learning what the experience of one of your fellow parents have gone through. And they may say, hey, you really should go see this doctor over here because they are doing well with TSC patients and they're following guidelines. And other times they are talking with government and they are talking with the seguros, the payers to get things approved. They're talking to hospital administrators about getting access to drugs or to get tests done when they need to get done. So those are all the things I would say for that. Dr. Northrup, do you have any other things you would add to that?
I think beautifully said. People have to be open-minded about new information that's come about since we all finished going to school. And you're talking to me, and I'm a rare disease every day, not just tuberous sclerosis, but everything I see is pretty much a rare disease. And we really have to be open-minded to try to get therapies for our patients. And if a doctor is not willing to listen to a parent, particularly about a child, I think that's not going to work because no one knows a child better than their own parents. I mean, no one can tell you more information about that child than the parents. So you need to listen to them and believe them and give them positive feedback for being open with you and trying to advocate for their child. I mean, I love it when people come in to me with new ideas, things that I may not have heard about in the 5,000 diseases I cover. So I think it, being open-minded is extremely important in your doctors, but also understanding that there is medical literature and there is information and there are things that are not, that have been shown to not be efficacious, that we should not pursue, or ideas that are just erroneous, like that vaccinations are bad as opposed to vaccinations for childhood diseases and all the wonderful, great things they've done. They're not bad. So it is a balancing act. I would agree with you.
Great. Again, thank you so much for your time today. And one final question from the chat. As you've been working to update these guidelines, what are the big questions that TSC researchers still need to tackle?
Dr. Northrup, why don't you go first?
Well, obviously, I think it's modifier genes, because I'm working on that. I think modifiers could potentially be very important. And I think that's a big area that's going to open up and give us a lot more information. I'm really excited about it.
And I think the probably two areas that relate to medication therapy. One is that the mTOR inhibitors clearly have been a major step forward, but they still leave us with many patients who don't respond as quickly or as dramatically as we want. We think some of those may be due to, as Dr. Northrup mentions, modifier genes that influence whether a drug works well or doesn't work well, makes a certain part of TSC able to respond versus not able to respond to that strategy. So understanding when and how mTOR inhibitors will continue to work for patients and when they won't, so that we go and keep looking for the next thing that will work, based on understanding why it's not working yet now, is pretty important. The second is we're shifting into, as we make the diagnosis, whether it's genetically or clinically, and understand there's more ways that TSC can look like in a person throughout their lifetime, we're looking to shift interventions earlier and earlier so that those changes that are occurring that we don't like are not cemented in, that we have a way to change them when the body is still willing to let us change them. And that involves, you know, early diagnosis, screening methods, knowing how to best use the surveillance testing. All of those are designed for us to know ahead of time what's going to happen so that we can start treatment sooner than later. So I think those are the two big frontiers from my standpoint.
Thank you. That's all the questions from the chat.
Dr. Ferreira, you're our moderator. Do you want to have any closing words or turn it over to anybody else? No,
I think it was an amazing webinar. I hope the participants have enjoyed also and have learned a lot with you. I know I have. And I was excited for the time of the webinar. So thank you very much again.
It's wonderful seeing all my friends from around the world, and I look forward to the day that we're back together face to face. So take care. We love you.
Yeah. One second. I'll go. Chris, you want to say something?
I was just going to hand it over to you and Carla, actually, and say,
oh, okay,
to round up.
Okay, so Carla and I would really like to say a big thank you firstly to our mentors, Dr. John Disler and Dr. Chris Kingswood, for working with us with throughout the Dare Pit Stops and their world webinars. And of course, a world of thanks to Hope and Darcy for this session and all the other doctors and key opinion leaders, past, present and future, who have joined us on this journey.
Yeah. We'd also like to thank the TSCi for joining us in this new adventure, all the TSC patient associations for their assistance in the organisation of the numerous DEA pit stops and meetings across the EU over the years, and for their support now with this new initiative with the DEA Forum.
And of course, we would like to thank the individuals with TSC and their families for coming to our meetings and giving us the strength and courage to move forward with our ideas.
And we look forward to welcoming you all again to our next initiatives, which we hope will be in the not too distant future.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.